Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, Professor of Surgery, Malacca Manipal Medical College, Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching videocasts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students doing the surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to listen these videos over and over again. In this episode, I am going to start a new series of videos on operative surgery. Because of the popular demand by the viewers of this channel, I have decided to create and upload common surgical operations. So in this video, I am going to talk about open appendectomy. However, I am not going to show you the real surgery. I am going to discuss only the theoretical aspect of the operative surgery of the open appendectomy. So what are the indications for appendectomy? This is acute appendicitis and subacute appendicitis. Anesthesia, you should give either general anesthesia, spinal or epidural. However, in pediatric patient, you should give only general anesthesia. Position of the patient, it is supine position with slight left tilt, so that all the small bubble lying over the cecum will be shifted to the left side. So then coming to the informed consent, before doing surgery, you have to get the informed consent from the patient. So you have to explain the risk of surgery or probable complications the patient may get. The post-op adhesion is 4% of these patients may go for post-op adhesions. 5% of these patients may get intra-abdominal abscess. 2% of them may go for fecal fistula. Wound infection is very high in case of perforative appendicitis. Overall mortality is from 0.2 to, it is in uncomplicated appendicitis, it is only 0.2. Whereas if it is a perforated appendicitis, the mortality may even go up to more than 10%. So you have to explain all these risks to the patient, get an informed consent before doing surgery. So what is the incision for this common surgery? So one is the classical is the McManus incision, that is denoted by the blue line here. So another one is slightly oblique incision, it is called Lance or modified McManus incision, this red line. And then another incision is pure, exactly a transverse line, that is called Rocky Davis incision. This is more commonly they are doing it in US. Suppose if the exposure is inadequate, you can extend the incision, this transverse incision, namely the Rocky Davis incision, either medially or laterally. If you extend it medially, it is called Fowler wave medial extension, where you will be cutting the rectus muscle, or at least you will be cutting the anterior rectal fascia and posterior rectal fascia. So if you are extending this transverse incision laterally, that is called Rutherford Morrison lateral extension, where you will be cutting the lateral three muscles, the external oblique, internal oblique and the transverses. Then after this skin incision and cutting the subcutaneous fat, you will be seeing the underlying glistening fascia. This is external oblique aponeurosis. The medial part, this is aponeurotic, whereas the lateral part, it will be muscular. So you have to incise this along the line of its fibers. So just beneath that, you will be seeing the two muscles. So namely the internal oblique and the transversus muscle. Both you have to split it. So you can do it after making a small hole in the muscle. Either you can use a scissor or you can use a fingers. That is what I used to do. Put two of your fingers inside and just I mean, bluntly, you have to dissect it. Or you can put two Richardson retractors, and bluntly, you can dissect this one. So you are only splitting the muscle across its fibers. Then after splitting this one, you will be seeing the underlying peritoneum. So you have to catch hold of the peritoneum with two hemostats, one by one, and then you have to cut open this peritoneum. But before cutting it, you have to pinch the area and make sure that you are not catching either the underlying bowel or the omentum. Make sure that nothing is under, you are not catching either the bowel or the omentum. Then you have to cut it with a knife. Here they have sewn it as scissors, but usually I will do it with a knife. Obliquely you have to cut it. Immediately after opening the peritoneum, sometimes you may see some fluid may come out. The turbid fluid may come out. If it is Frankfurt or whatever may be the discharge, you have to send it for culture sensitivity. You have to take a swab and you have to send it for culture and sensitivity. So then you have to, now you have gone into the peritoneal cavity, so you have to search for the cecum. Sometimes there may be small bowel lying, maybe lying over the cecum. So you have to push all those things to the medial side. Then you can identify the cecum by looking into the tinea coli. That is the hallmark sign for the cecum. Then you can just catch hold of this tinea coli with a Babcock's forceps and you can pull it out. The cecum, you can pull it out by doing what is called a rocking movement. You can use either the Babcock or you can even use a dry gauze, catch hold of the cecum and just try to pull it out. This is how you have to take it out. The three tinea coli converge at the base of the appendix. So the confluence of all these three tinea coli is the base of the appendix. So before going further, let us review a few points in the anatomy of the appendix. So appendix is, yeah, it is attached to the base of the cecum where the three tinea coli converge. And this is the appendix. This looks inflamed. So this is the cecum and this is the ascending colon and this is the terminal ileum. So the blood supply to the appendix is through the mesoappendix, that is appendicular artery, which is a branch of ileocolic artery. The ileocolic artery in turn is a branch of superior mesenteric artery. So this appendix can lie in like a face of a clock. It can lie at 12 o'clock position or 1 o'clock position. It may be on any position. So it may be pre-ileal or post-ileal, or it may be pelvic, or it may be paracecal, or sometimes it may be retrocecal. These are the common position for the appendix. Tip may be anywhere. It is variable, but always the base is always constant. So base is nothing but the confluence of these three tinea coli. So after identifying the appendix, so you have to do what is called skeletonization of the mesoappendix. This you can do, you have to clamp and divide the mesoappendix serially. First, you have to begin it, ultimately you have to cut it like this. So completely you have to devascularize the appendix. Then you have to crush the base of the appendix either with a right angle forceps like this, or you can use a straight artery forceps. Just crush it for a few minutes. Then you have to remove that hemostat and then you have to reapply few centimeters distal to this area here, somewhere here. So then you have to put a ligature over the crush mark here. You have to put a ligature. Usually I use Vicryl for this one. So you have to ligate this area. Then you have to transect some 0.5 centimeter distally with a knife. So you have to cut it. And then you have to dispose this knife and then this appendix and this clamp separately. You have to, but before cutting it, you can place a gauze piece just beneath that so that whatever spillage is coming out, it will get soaked only in the gauze piece. So you have to remove that gauze piece and you have to give this knife and appendix along with this hemostat. Everything you have to give to the scrub nurse, so that they will dispose it separately. So there is some alternate method. Instead of this right angle forceps or the mixed forceps, you can use a straight artery forceps, or you can use a linear stapler also. This is a GIS stapler, not only in the laparoscopic surgery, even in open surgery, you can use it to divide both the mesoappendix as well as the base of the appendix. So then what to do with the appendicular stump? Usually I won't bury, I never, so far I have never buried the appendix stump, but all my patients so far there was no complication at all. But the classically they recommend, so you have to bury the appendicular stump by making either a piercing suture or a Z stitch, that is jet tape stitch you have to make, and then you have to invert the stump inside so that you want to avoid any mucosal formation. But usually I will touch the protruding mucosa of the appendix with a cautery. So I will cauterize it, and then I never bury this stump. So suppose if the appendix is lying retrocecal, how to handle this one? So you may not be able to deliver the tip of the appendix because it is adherent, it is retrocecal. So now in this case, you have to make a small window at the base of the appendix, then you have to crush the base of the appendix with a straight artery forceps, and then you have to put a ligature there, and then you have to apply a clamp just distal to this ligature, and then first you have to divide the appendix from the base. That you have to do it first, and this method of appendicectomy is called anti-grade appendicectomy. Then after dividing this appendix, you can either bury this stump or you can just touch it with a cautery. Then you have to try to mobilize the appendix. So this is the mesoappendix. So you have to serially, you have to clamp the mesoappendix until you are going to reach the tip of the appendix. But sometimes you will encounter the peritoneum laterally here. So then you have to divide that congenital line of fusion, that is tolt, white line of tolt. You have to divide it, and then you have to mobilize the cecum as if you are going to do, this is what we used to do in hemicolectomy, but it is limited only for the, not the entire ascending colon, only in the part where there is cecum. You have to divide that white line of tolt, then you have to mobilize the cecum, and then easily you can, under vision, you can see, you can divide this peritoneum, and you can go up to the tip of the appendix. Sometimes if the tip of appendix, if it goes very high, say up to the even sometimes subhepatic region, you are likely to injure two structures. So you have to beware of injuring the duodenum or injuring the right ureter. These injuries you should avoid. So finally, before closing the peritoneum, you have to wash the peritoneal cavity locally, not the general peritoneal cavity, only this area you have to wash with povidine iodine. Then close the peritoneum with Vicryl with a continuous suture here. Then you have to close the muscle, both the muscles you can close with the same Vicryl, but here interrupted suture you have to use. Then finally you have to close the external oblique aponeurosis. This you can do either continuous or interrupted. And finally you can close the skin with subcuticular stitch. So thank you very much for watching this video. But I recommend, after seeing this video, I recommend all of you to go and watch the real open appendicectomy surgery in the following two links. These are YouTube videos which you can go and you can visualize it. So after going through these videos, my video and these two videos, it is, you can do this is mainly for the surgical trainees. You can do what is called a mental rehearsal for the actual surgery. When, so if you are watching these videos, when you are going to actually encounter or actually going to do a surgery, it will be easier for you. So if you think that these videos are very useful, kindly share with your friends. So thank you once again for watching this video. Okay, bye bye, until we are going to meet in another video. Bye.